الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلوات الله وسلامه على نبينا الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تمسك بسنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we have now inshallah ta'ala in this symposium that we're going to put forth a golden opportunity for the brothers to have their questions answered as well as the sisters, and we're going to try our best to make the issue fair between the two groups. So we want to take this opportunity out just to introduce to you brothers, if you don't know some of them by now, some of the people are participating from the panel. And we're going to start from my immediate left, and we're going to go down the table accordingly. So right to my left is my sheikh that I had the opportunity to meet a few months ago in Canada. And since we went back to Orlando, we've been speaking about him to our students there, and they've gotten an opportunity to meet him. And it is our sheikh and our beloved sheikh Abu Hatim Usama Al-Qusi, who lives in Egypt, and he has his well-known scholastic efforts. And to his left we have, after that, one of the shuyukh who are participating here in this year's conference, who I met here only for the first time, but I heard quite a bit about him, and that is Abu Abdurrahman Waleed Al-Basyuni, who is now an imam here and his da'wah is here in Texas. And then we have to his left the one who I would consider my oldest sheikh here in this whole conference, who we met at least 6 years ago in London. He used to come almost every single year to participate in the efforts over there, and that's one of the reasons that the da'wah was so strong in England. Because when the doors of the Dawah to Salafiyah opened up to England, they opened up towards Jordan. That's one of the great virtues that those brothers had over the American people here. And that is our Sheikh Abu Usama Al-Kabir Salim Al-Hilali. And then to his left, we have my colleague and my companion from the days in Medina, who La Nuzakki Alallahi Ahada, who was probably the main reason that the da'wah was established in East Orange, New Jersey. And that's our brother who's well known to us, Abu Tasneem Dawood Adib. And then we have our brother, mashallah, who Allah Ta'ala has blessed with the memorization of the Qur'an, and who is working now, alhamdulillah, to be of those people who are trying to be one of the pillars of the da'wah, is our brother Yahya, who's also from Canada. So what we're going to have now, inshallah, is each individual, each sheikh is going to say a few words. Yahya is going to give the translation. And we look at Yahya as being the main translator at these conferences. Yahya is the main translator because he brings life to these translations. When I came here and we saw that the Sheikh Muhammad Hassan was talking and people were crying, wallahi, that type of tears and that type of sound, it should make us feel happy that we can always have these types of talks that have an effect and an impact on our hearts, as opposed to be of the people who are always مُخْتَلِفُونَ فِي مَا بَيْنَ أَنفُسِهِمْ. They always have this ikhtilaf and this hatred towards one another. So Yahya is going to be the translator. After each person talks for 5, 7, 10 minutes, after that, the opportunity will be left to each brother and sister out there to put their question across, inshallah ta'ala.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هداه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأنصحكم حفظكم الله أنصحكم وقد دخلتم بفضل الله تعالى في هذا الدين، منكم من ولد من أبوين مسلمين ومنكم من دخل في هذا الدين بعد أن كان على غيره، أنصحكم بالاهتمام بتعلم اللغة العربية، لأن فهم معاني القرآن وفهم معاني الأحاديث لا يمكن أبدا أن يغني عن تعلم الكتاب والسنة من الكتاب والسنة بلغة الكتاب والسنة. ف النصيحة الأولى أن تهتموا بتعلم اللغة العربية، وإن كان هذا شاقا عليكم في بادئ الأمر، لكن الله يهونه، وربنا جل في علاه يقول ولقد يسرنا القرآن للذكر فهل من مدكر، فإن شاء الله تعالى هو يسير على من يسره الله عليه. وتعلم العربية قد يفتح عليكم إن شاء الله أبوابا كثيرة من الخير. النصيحة الثانية، الحمد لله قد عرفتم هذا الدين بصفائه ونقائه، فإياكم إياكم أن تدخلوا في القوالب الضيقة أو في الحزبيات المقيتة. احتفظوا بإسلامكم الصافي الفطري الذي هو بعيد عن كل هذه القوالب الضيقة والأحزاب التي تشوه صورة الإسلام. فهذه هي النصيحة الثانية. النصيحة الثالثة أنكم إن شاء الله تهتمون بطلب العلم وتحاولون تحصيل ما أمكنكم تحصيله عن طريق الأشرطة والرسائل المترجمة في هذه الفترة إلى أن ييسر الله لكم بتعلم اللغة العربية. وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبارك فيكم وأن ينفعكم وأن ينفع بكم قومكم، وصلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Sheikh Abu Hatim Usam Al-Qusi began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending his peace and blessings upon the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The words that he gave us were words of advice. The first piece of advice that he has given us is by saying that after we have entered, or you have entered into the state of Islam, some of us after having known different religions, it is important for us to focus your attention to the fact that it is important to begin in the struggle of learning the Arabic language. This is his first piece of advice to us and you. For the Quran and the Hadith, although you may learn or understand parts of it, you will never be able to understand it unless you study the Quran and the Sunnah in the language that they were brought down in. So this is how it must be understood by all of us. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Qur'an, surely we have made the remembrance or the reminder, the Qur'an, easy for those who wish to remember it and to work with it. So whoever wishes to learn this language and learn the Qur'an with sincere intention and with sincere prioritization shall do so inshaAllah. The second piece of advice that the Shaykh Hafidhahullah has given us is that he advises us not to fall into sectarianism, not to fall into making Islam smaller, to come into small clans and groups fighting amongst one another. For Islam is vast and it's all encompassing of those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to limit it in such a manner. The third piece of advice and the final piece of advice that the Shaykh Hafidhahullah gave us was talabul ilm, to seek religious knowledge. And to seek this with sincerity. At the time being, until you are learning the Arabic language, do so through tapes, publications, in such a manner, learning from the people of knowledge who may be in and around you. All in the same time, learning and striving and putting the priority of the Arabic language in your final goal. The Shaykh ended by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people who call to the path of Islam and to make Islam benefit from our lives. Allahumma ameen. Ameen.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وبعد، أيها الإخوة الكرام، فإنني أنصح نفسي وإياكم بما قد ذكره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما رواه الإمام البخاري في صحيحه عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الرفق ما وضع في شيء إلا زانه، وما رفع من شيء إلا شانه. الرفق ما كان في شيء إلا زانه، وما رفع من شيء إلا شانه، أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. الرفق هو مبدأ الأمر وأصله، وقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لن يشاد الدين أحد إلا غلبه.
The Sheikh began by advising himself and us with the important hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari from Aisha radiallahu anha, that she said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, never is rifq, and this word I did not come up with a one word translation, so I will give you a few. Kindness, ease of manner. Never is this kindness and ease of manner placed into something except that it will uphold it and make it easier and easier. And never is this kindness and ease in dealing with someone taken out of something except that it will make it more difficult and harder to be processed. And also, and the Prophet also says, never will someone struggle with the religion or try to pull into it or delve into it except that he will be pulled from it, except that the deen in itself will pull him from it.
فالرفق يكون بنفسك في تدينك، ويكون في تعلمك، ويكون في تعاملك مع إخوانك. لأنني رأيت أن كثيرا من إخواننا الذين دخلوا في الإسلام أو الذين توجهوا للخير والعلم عندهم نوع من فقدان الرفق بأنفسهم وإخوانهم، حتى أن الواحد منهم إذا تكلم يتكلم وأعصابه مشدودة، ويتصرف وأعصابه مشدودة، وتجد أنه لا يأخذ الأمور بشيء من البساطة والهدوء وبشيء من الطبيعة، يعني يصبح كأنه سجية، لا، بل يتكلف له تكلفا، فيتكلف في العلم، ويتكلف في العبادة، ويتكلف في التعلم، ويتكلف في التعامل. لا، ارفق. والرفق ليس معناه التكاسل، والرفق ليس معناه التخاذل، والرفق ليس معناه المداهنة أبدا. الرفق هو أن يأخذ الإنسان ويسوس الإنسان نفسه بما يصلحها وينفعها، وأن لا يضغط على نفسه حتى يكون فظا غليظا. والله يقول: ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. فالرفق أمر مهم جدا يا إخواني. ارفقوا بأنفسكم، ارفقوا بأهليكم، ارفقوا بتعلمكم. فإني رأيت بعض إخواننا يسألون مسائل في العلم، لما يسألونني إياها أقول: الرفق، الرفق، فأنت دون ذلك بكثير، بعيد أن تصل إلى هذه المراحل. وتجد الواحد يتشدد على إخوانه ويضيق عليهم في التعامل وعلى أهل بيته. يجب أن يكون رفيق، وأن يعلم أن الأمور تؤخذ بالتدريج، وأن من حاز العلم جملة ذهب جملة، ومن ظن أنه سيتدين الإسلام كله في يوم من الليلة لن يحصل. لكن عليك أن تبدأ بأصل الأصول وهو التوحيد، ثم تعلم، ثم تربط قلبك بالله تبارك وتعالى واليوم الآخر والجنة والنار، وتعلم أحكام العلم من خلال إخوانك الذين سبقوك في هذا المجال، ومن خلال تعلمك للسان العربية كما تفضل شيخنا أبي حاتم. وأختم وأقول: اعلموا بالنسبة للغة العربية أنه لا علم بالإنجليزية. I believe you understood what he said. يعني there is no knowledge in English language. Don't ever think about, forget about it. طيب، لا يوجد علم. There is no knowledge in English. نعم، نحن لا نؤيد هذا الأسلوب. العلم، I mean the knowledge to be a scholar, a student of knowledge, but to have knowledge, يعني to correct your ibadah, your worship, this possible. والله أعلم.
The Shaykh Hafidhahullah, he continued by saying, this ease and kindness, this rif. this ease and kindness and easygoing manner.
Don't be tight.
Nah. Allahu Akbar. Must be upheld when dealing with oneself and when dealing with other people. And the loss of this ease and kindness in dealing with oneself and other people is one of the major issues that is facing the Muslim brothers here today. Not just here, but in our time especially. The Sheikh says, you will constantly be confronted by people who are hyper, they're always under stress, tension, in the way they are dealing with other people, the way they ask their questions, the way they approach the issues in dealing with themselves and their family, in the way that they are seeking knowledge. This ease and kindness, it is not to be misunderstood and to be thought of as being lazy or being laid back or easygoing and forgetting what is to be done. It is something that is to uphold the benefit to oneself while not transgressing upon oneself. To uphold the ease of oneself while not being extravagant in how you are dealing with yourself or other people. Also, the Sheikh says, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered and spoke of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his character in dealing with the Sahaba, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ. And if you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was a person who was harsh and strict and was not lenient, those who are around you today would have dispersed from you, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Shaykh asked the question, when a person came to the Shaykh and asking him the question, and they ask questions that are very difficult, and the Shaykh can see that the person who is asking this question is not up to the level and is making things difficult for himself and others, the ones that he is dealing with. So the Shaykh, when he answers him and he says, take it easy, be kind, be respectful of others and take it one step at a time, this is the answer that is most deserved of the brothers who may have approached him. Also, it is important to know that knowledge and seeking knowledge and understanding will not come in one day and one night. You're not going to wake up one day and you're going to know it all or go to sleep one night as such. But you should take it into steps, and the Shaykh gives us three steps. Begin with learning the fundamentals of Tawheed. Begin in linking your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and tazkiyah, purifying yourself and your family and reminding yourself of this. Also, as Abu Hatim pointed out, also strive in learning the Arabic language. And as the Sheikh ended on what you may think is a comical note, it is not funny. It is important to understand that this English language, it will help you until you are ready to be serious in learning the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is found in the Arabic language, as Allah has promised to protect the Qur'an and the Sunnah through this. So these are the words that the Shaykh has left us with. فَلْيَتَفَضَّلْ Shaykh Abu Usama al-Kabir, inshaAllah. Allah
Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على الله نبينا بعده وبعد ذكر الله تبارك وتعالى في أواخر سورة الفرقان صفات عباد الرحمن فقال وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما. أول صفة امتدح الله بها عباده هي التواضع والإخبات، ليدلنا أن عبد الله بالتواضع ينتفع بآيات الله وينتفع بالعلم وينتفع بما أتاه الله تبارك وتعالى، لأنه قبل هذه الآية ذكر آياته في الكون فقال تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا وهو الذي جعل الليل والنهار خلفة لمن أراد أن يذكر أو أراد شكورا، ثم قال وعباد الرحمن. أو أن الذين ينتفعون بآيات الله في الكون، الذين ينتفعون بآيات الله في أنفسهم، الذين ينتفعون بآيات الله المتلوة عليهم في كتاب الله، هم الذين يتواضعون لله، يتواضعون لعباد الله، يتواضعون في كل شيء من حياتهم. ولذلك فإن التواضع يا أخواني حمية طالب العلم، حمية طالب العلم. إذا طالب العلم تواضع لله رفعه الله، وإذا تكبر قصمه الله. وفي ذلك يقول بعض الشعراء: فاعلم أن والعلم حرب للفتى المتعالي كالسيل حرب للمكان العالي. والتواضع هو قبول الحق وعدم احتقار الناس، لأن الكبر هو بطر الحق وغمض الناس. فينبغي علينا أن نتواضع لله، وأن نعرف أحجامنا حقا، وأن نعرف أننا كلما ازددنا علما ازددنا علما بجهلنا. ولذلك قال بعض العلماء: العلم ثلاثة أشبار. من دخل في الشبر الأول تكبر، ومن دخل في الشبر الثاني تواضع، ومن دخل في الشبر الثالث علم أنه لا يعلم. فلا تكن أبا شبر، دخل في الشبر الأول ووقف على أبوابه لم يتجاوزه. نسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن يجعلني وإياكم من المتواضعين لله، المخبتين لله تبارك وتعالى.
The Shaykh Hafizahullah began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings upon his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and by reciting to us and reminding us of Surah Al-Furqan, the last page and a half from it. The Shaykh points to us the characteristics of the slaves of Allah, wa ibadur rahman, the slaves of Allah. Allah lists their characteristics and how their attitudes are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says near the end of Surah Al-Furqan, and the servants of Ar-Rahman, the slaves, the servants of Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are those. And Allah begins, as the Shaykh points out, by mentioning that they are humble and have humility. Are those who, when they walk upon the face of the earth and they are approached by those who are ignorant, they say to them, Salama, peace be to you, humble, in a state of humility, not in a state of anger or transgression. And this is important for us to understand, for the Shaykh says, the one who will truly benefit from the verses of Allah is the one who is humble and has humility in the sight of Allah and in the sight of mankind. And this is proved by the verses in this same surah. For the verse that came right before Allah listing the servants of Ar-Rahman's characteristics, Allah says, Tabarak alladhi, glory and honor and praise be to Allah who has created such and such, the moon, the sun, the stars. Allah lists His creation. And then Allah says, Wa ibadur rahman alladhina, the servants of the Rahman are those who do such and such and such. And the first of that is humbleness and humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the Shaykh Hafizahullah, he mentions to us that a true person of knowledge, the one who seeks knowledge, is the one who knows that the more he knows, the less he knows. The more he knows is the less that he knows. As the Shaykh gives us the example of the statement of one of the people of the past, where he says, knowledge is of three steps or three levels or three handspans. The first, when a person reaches the first step of knowledge, he thinks of himself as great and large and big, I know. And then when he reaches the second step of knowledge, he becomes humbled to Allah. And when he reaches the third step of knowledge, he knows now that he does not know anything. So these are the steps. So the person who narrated the three steps says, therefore do not allow yourself to fall into the category of the first type of people who thinks of himself as knowing all, when in fact he does not know much. And this is where the Shaykh had ended off, Hafidhahullah. Now we will be listening to Shaykh Dawood Adib.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa nusalli wa nusallam ala Rasulihi al-Ameen. Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Wa ba'd. I'd like, inshallah, to place the horse before the cart. For these illustrious individuals sitting to my right have mentioned all of those subsidiary things that are important for us. And the horse that we like to place in the front is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in his book, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, that they were not commanded to do anything except have ikhlas, pure intention in the deen. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he has said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, that actions are judged by intentions. And because of this, many of the scholars of the past, like Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, they placed in many of their books, in the beginning of the book, this narration, actions are judged by intentions. So that when the reader, when the seeker of knowledge, and the one who wants to be modest, and the one who wants to learn how to be kind and gentle, and all of those qualities that we should have that these mashayikh have mentioned, they will open the book and they will see that the first thing they need to do is purify their intentions. This is number one on the list, that they should purify their intention. And as some of the people of the past have said, رُبَّمَا عَمَلٍ صَغِيرًا تُعَذِبُهُ النِّيَّةِ تُعَذِمُهُ النِّيَّةِ وَرُبَّمَا عَمَلٍ كَبِيرٍ تُصَغِيرُهُ النِّيَّةِ. Perhaps a small deed, a minuscule deed, a seemingly insignificant act can be magnified by the niyyah. And perhaps a great, humongous, magnificent act can be made small by the niyyah. So we must purify our intentions, and we must keep focus on our intentions, and make sure that we're not seeking this knowledge, learning this noble deen of Islam, for any other reason except for the pleasure of Allah and to learn how to worship Allah properly. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
After that, brothers and sisters, we'd like to thank all of the participants on the panel for their introduction, inshallah. Now we're going to get to what we would consider the meat and the nitty gritty of this issue. What I tried to do in giving the questions was, I tried to pick those questions that are very important and we find ourselves falling into them all the time. Before reading these questions, there are two things. Number one, I want to call all of your attention to the importance of paying attention now. Because if you can imagine, if we were living with some ulama of the past, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, Al-Imam Muslim, if we were living with Al-Imam Yahya ibn Ma'in and these people, and they were all at one place, how important it would be for you to take the information and pay attention of what's going to be said. Now you're going to get your questions answered now, and you can say in the future, I heard Sheikh so-and-so say such and such a thing. But if your mind is all over the place, the information is going to go over your head. So these questions are the problems that I face and you face. So here are the answers. This question about the henna of the woman, I'm only going to answer it because I feel that the girl really is having a problem because she said, please, please, please answer it. But the other questions are more important, inshallah. But just to show these women that there is no small thing in the religion, we're going to answer this question first, inshallah. As the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la yahqiranna ahadukum shay'an min al-ma'roof. So we're not going to make it small. The question is, is it permissible for the woman to wear the henna and to make names and designs on her body? And if she does so, does she have to take it off for the salah? That's the question that we're going to start with, to show the amah of Allah, the handmaidens of Allah, that we pay attention to them, even though the qawama is for the rijal. Yas'al aw tas'al al-mar'a ya shaykh al-hinna istikhdamuha hal هي يجوز هل هي تجوز ولا تجوز وإذا استخدمتها المرأة هل هي مانعة من وصول الماء في الوضوء؟ نعم انت مدقق يا شيخ. انا وترجم
الله اكبر. نصر من الله وفتح قريب.
ما شفت اخي يحيى خشيت ان يحيى يقول لي ويز يور رفق.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هداه. تسأل هذه سائلة حفظها الله وزادها حرصا على معرفة أمور دينها، هل يجوز استعمال الحناء وهل هذا يمنع من الطهارة ومن وصول الماء إلى الجسم؟ الجواب لا إشكال أبدا في استخدام المرأة للحناء، مرأة تستخدم الحناء، وهي تسأل أيضا هل يجوز أن تزخرف بها جسم يديها وكذا وتكتب كلمات أو أشكالا؟ يجوز إن شاء الله، كل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق. الأصل في الزينة الإباحة، وهذا طبعا معروف أنه لا يبدى للأجانب، فهي تفعله لنفسها في بيتها، لا تخرج بيديها محناة في الشارع مكشوفة هكذا، لا تبدي زينتها لأحد، وهذا لا يمنع من الطهارة، فليست الحناء حاجزا بين الماء وبين البشرة. الحناء كانت تستخدم قديما وكان النساء يتحنين، ما يمنع الحناء، لا تمنع من وصول الماء إلى البشرة، والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم.
The Sheikh حفظه الله answers the question by saying there is no problem in using henna. Even if it is to be used in drawing or writing words on the person's body, for this is part of beauty that is given to the woman that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has caused to be permitted, and it does not break the person's wudu, or wudu if it is applied over it, it will be valid insha'Allah. The only restriction that the Shaykh and the ulama have put is that this beautification of the body is not to be displayed to any strangers. Anyone outside the immediate family of this Muslim sister is not to be see this outside the home, and it is not to be performed for those who are not permitted to look at it.
There's one point. Some girls, some women, I'll say that English, try. Some women, they don't want to put tattoo, like kafar. What she's doing is, she put henna and make decors like tattoos to imitate the kuffar. Some they make any hila, trick. She don't want to make tattoo like kuffar, so she decorate herself, I like the kuffar. So nobody who knows this henna or tattoo. This intention, it's not halal, it's haram. Because I have been told about some girls, they imitate the kuffar by this way, make a trick, she make herself smart. She's dealing with Allah. She's not dealing with anybody of our human being.
Now the next question is, if a person was to fall into the crime of a zina, what is the best way that we as a community should go about dealing with that person's situation here in America and in light of the lifestyle in America? هذا السؤال إليك يا أبا عبد الرحمن. إذا وقع أحد في جريمة الزنا، ما هي طريقة الأمثل في أمريكا في التعاون معه وفي موضوعه؟ هل نقاطعه؟ هل نهجره؟ ما هي طريقة الأمثل؟
وكيف نعامله؟
نعم.
وقع في الزنا،
وقع فيها.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، وبعد، الذي يقع في جريمة الزنا يجب أن ننظر إلى هذا الوقوع، هل هو وقوع مرة أم وقوع متكرر عادة له يقع دائما؟ فإذا كان الرجل وقع فيه مرة فإننا نقول له وننصحه ونبين له حكم الله في هذا الأمر، ونقول له إن الزنا من كبائر الذنوب عند الله تبارك وتعالى، وقد استوجب حدا في الدنيا، ويجب عليك أن تخشى عقوبة الزنا، فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رأى الزنات في تنور يغلي بهم، هذا عذابهم، تنور يغلي بهم وهم عراة يصرخون، ويذكر بالله ويخوف بالله. ولا تهجروا يا إخواني،
ولا تهجروه، إنما انصحوه وارفقوا به واعيدوا عليه التكرار والكرة، واقطعوا عنه أسباب الفتنة. إن كان غير متزوج زوجوه، إن كان بسبب عمله ساعدوا على أن ينتقل من وظيفته، ينتقل من بلده، لا بد أن تضع أيديكم في يده. أما إذا كان رجلا مدمنا هذا للعمل دائما تنصحه لكن ما في فائدة، يا ابن الحلال لا تقع في هذه المصيبة، ما في فائدة ينصحه، فهذا أيضا لا أرى أنه يهجر، لا أرى أنه يهجر، لكنه لا يصاحب ولا يقرب، لا يصاحب، وإنما يعطى حقوق الأخوة العامة ويسلم عليه ويبقى شخص قريب من يستطيع ينصحه من فترة إلى أخرى، لكنه لا يصاحب. أما إذا وجد وقع هذا مرة ينبغي أن لا نتركه، لا سيما هنا، لا تتركوا أخوكم للشيطان، ولكن أعينوا أخوكم، أعينوا أخاكم على الشيطان. والله أعلم.
The Sheikh answers this question.
عفوا. ولا يوجد حدود في أمريكا، ما أحد يجوز له يقيم الحد عليه، لا بإذنه ورضاه ولا بغير إذنه ورضاه. ولو هو قال جاء لإمام المسجد قال طهرني يا شيخ واضرب بظهري يا شيخ عشان أطهر، هذا لا يجوز، إنما الذي يقيم الحدود ولي الأمر فقط، ولو كان فاعل الجريمة هو الذي يريد الحد، هذا لا يسمى حد، هذه بدعة في الدين، إنما الحد يقيمه ولي الأمر، وليس لكم هنا ولي أمر.
The Sheikh Hafidhahullah answers this question by saying, if the person has fornicated and has committed adultery, whether the person is a fornicator or an adulterer, if we must first find out, is this something that he has done once, or is this something that he has become accustomed to, always fornicating, always going out in such a manner, and has become used to and addicted to committing zina and fornication. As for the first example, if he is a person who has just committed zina once, this is a person that we must take under us and advise him and show him the truth, remind him of Allah, tell him that this is a major sin, show him the proofs from the Qur'an and the Sunnah, advise him and make it clear to him, and help him to overcome it. If he is not married, find him a wife. If he is in a state of struggle, help him out of it. If the city that he is living in is influencing, causing him to do this, move him away from the city. Help him to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as for the person who is used to it, and the Sheikh points out that under no circumstances should you abandon this person. You should not say, this person has done this, therefore I will never talk to him again, and the whole community turns their back on him. This is something that should not be done. As for the person who has committed this and is known to be constantly committing fornication and is used to it, you still should not abandon him. But you should not take him as a friend, as a person who you return to in trust and in friendship. But you should not abandon him, you should still advise him with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sheikh finally mentions a point where he says, under no circumstances can you take the laws into your own hand. Even if the person comes to you and says, I have committed this, it's 100 lashes, come and whip me. Even if he comes and agrees, you are still not permitted to perform this, even if you are the imam of the masjid, for this is not enough authority to perform this in any parts of America. And this is where the Sheikh had ended.
The next question is, there is no shyness in the deen. So if a man makes ghusl after sex, then goes and he prays, and then after the prayer he finds that there is some dry semen on his body, was his ghusl complete, and what is the position and the condition of his salah? First of all, ikhwan, there is shyness in the religion. There is no shyness in the deen is a false statement. Sheikh Abu Usama yas'al al-sa'il, la haya fi al-deen. فإذا اختصر الرجل بعضا قضى حاجته مع حليلته ثم ذهب إلى المسجد ليصلي فيه فصلى صلاته ثم بعد الصلاة تبين له أن هناك مني جاف على جسمه
فما حكم غسله وما حكم صلاته؟
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. أما قول السائل لا حياء في الدين فهذا كلام غير صحيح، فإن الدين كله حياء، وإن كان المقصود أن الحياء لا يمنع من السؤال ومن طلب العلم، لكن هذه الجملة غير صحيحة بهذا العبارة، لأن الدين كله حياء والحياء خلق الإسلام. الأمر الثاني أنه إذا اغتسل بعد قضاء حاجاته ثم ذهب إلى الصلاة وصلى، إذا كان الماء قد عم بدنه وأتى بواجبات الاغتسال فغسله صحيح، ووجود المن الجاف على شيء من ثيابه لا يمنع صحة صلاته، والله أعلم، لأن المن غير نجس، والله أعلم.
وإن كان على جسده المني،
إن كان حال بينه وبين وصول الماء فعليه إعادة الغسل، والله أعلم.
أو الصلاة،
والصلاة كذلك.
نعم.
The sheikh answers the question by saying, as for the point where the person begins a question by saying there is no shyness or humility in religion, this is a false statement. But if you are meaning that you are free to ask all that you wish in search of seeking knowledge, this is true. For the religion of Islam is based on shyness. And this is from the character of Islam to have this humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for the person who has performed this ghusl and has went to the masjid and has prayed, and after his prayer he found that the mani was stuck to his clothing, and he had fulfilled the requirements of al-ikhtisal, of taking the bath properly, then he would not have to return to and perform a new ghusl and a new prayer. I asked the sheikh, what if he found that the semen was found on his body itself? He said, and the sheikh answered, if the semen was on his skin and the water did not touch his skin, therefore he would have to take a new bath and he would have to repeat his salah.
For Brother Dawuddin, if the Torah and the Injil are not the actual books, then how can we explain the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his description in them, if they're not the true books? If the Torah and the Bible are not the actual books, how can we explain the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam description in them?
The first thing I think we have to do is we have to determine if those descriptions that are mentioned in those books that are called today, the Old and New Testament that people think are the Torah and the Injil, are actually correct. If we have affirmed and authenticated the fact that those books are correct, then we can say that maybe those descriptions are of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Until that's done, then it's a moot issue, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not tell us in the Quran that those books that we have now are from Him, as we mentioned this morning. So the first thing we have to do is determine if those books are correct. And we know that those books are not correct. We believe in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
The question is that many of our sisters prior to al-Islam, they are guilty of having abortions. I would like to know what will happen to those children. Are they from the occupants of the hellfire or from the paradise? And what do we, are they from the occupants of the hellfire or the paradise? الشيخ أبو حاتم تسأل السائلة أجحدنا كثير من أخواتنا قبل الإسلام أولادهن فماذا يفعل بهؤلاء الأولاد هم من أهل النار أو من أهل الجنة؟
هؤلاء الأولاد الذي قتلوا قتلنا أولادهن، فما مسير الأولاد؟
هذا يجب ينبه يعني على النفس جنة ولا خصص رب العالمين أهل بوثيهم.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد، فالسائلة تسأل عن حكم الأولاد الذين تم إجهاضهم قبل الإسلام، ما حكم هؤلاء الأولاد؟ مسألة كأنها تسأل عن حكم أولاد الكفار، كأنها يعني تسأل عن هذا الأمر. وأولاد الكفار مختلف فيهم بين أهل العلم، والراجح والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم كما رجحه الحافظ ابن حجر في كتابه فتح الباري على صحيح الإمام البخاري، أن الأطفال أولاد الناس، احتج برواية أولاد الناس على أن الأطفال إذا ماتوا قبل البلوغ فهم في الجنة. فهذا هو الراجح في المسألة عند الحافظ ابن حجر، وهو الذي أيضا ارتحت إليه، وإلا فالمسألة خلافية قديمة والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم. ثم يعني لا ينبغي أن ننشغل بمثل هذه المسألة التي لا يترتب عليها كبير عمل، لا يترتب عليها كبير عمل. وقد سئل الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعض الأحيان عن حكم الأطفال فقال الله أعلم بما كانوا عاملين. فهذه الأمور يعني لا ينبغي أن تكون هي محل اهتمامنا، والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم.
The Sheikh answers the question by saying, it seems that the sister or the brother who may have asked this question is asking it in a point, are these children like the children of the disbelievers who die? So the Sheikh answers in regards to this question, there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars whether the child will enter the Jannah or the fire. As for the closest statement that the Sheikh feels is what Al-Imam Ibn Hajar has said in Fath al-Bari, the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, where he says, if the child has passed away before puberty, he shall be admitted to the Jannah. And the Sheikh says, but as for these questions, it is not really important to concern ourselves with it, because none of your actions shall be built on it. It's not something that you're going to go out and work with after this. So this is important to take note. And knowing that when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at different times was asked about children, whether they are from the people of the fire or paradise, he would many times answer by saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the actions that they would have committed. So this is enough of an answer for us, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just and wise.
Our children who came from zina prior to al-Islam, are we responsible for them? And if we're not responsible to spend on them out of our monies as an obligation, how do we explain to the non-Muslims and giving them da'wah about the justice of al-Islam?
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد، فهذه أو هذا يسأل عن الأولاد الذين أتوا من طريق الزنا، هل يجب علينا النفقة عليهم شرعا، أو هل يعتبرون أولاد شرعيين لمن وقع في جريمة الزنا؟ وإن كانت لا تجب النفقة، فكيف نقول لغير المسلمين، أو نبين لغير المسلمين عدل الإسلام وعدالته؟ هكذا؟
هو هكذا.
الحمد لله.
مهما كانوا نفس الشيء.
نقول هذا السؤال يختلف باختلاف السائل، فإن كان السائل ذكر فهو ليس بولد شرعي له، إن كان من زنا فهو ليس بولد شرعي له، ولا تجب عليه النفقة في حقه، كما قرر ذلك الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى وغيره من الفقهاء المحققين. وأما الأم فهو ينسب إليها وهي مسؤولة عن هذا الولد. وهنا يسأل يقول، فكيف نقول إذن للكفار بعدل الإسلام إذا كان الوالد لا ينفق عليه؟ أنا ما قلت لك لا تنفق عليه، كيف تبي تنفق عليه؟ الله يقويك. إذا أردت أن تنفق عليه الله يقويك، لكن نحن نقول هل يلزمك وجوبا شرعيا أن تنفق عليه؟ نقول لا، لأنه ليس بولد لك في الأصل، ليس بولد لك في الأصل، وإنما هو ينسب إلى أمه، وأمه ملزمة به. هذا إذا كان يعني ولد زنا. أما إن كان ولد نكاح باطل أو نكاح بشبهة فإنه ولد له. نعم.
The question that the Sheikh received answers it by saying it depends on the different situations. If the child who this has come out of zina, the father, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim has stated, is not responsible in a monetary way, does not have to give money to raise the child, is not responsible for him with wealth. The mother is now the one who is required, and the child is given, the child is under her care. The Sheikh says, now as for the second part of the question, which is how do we speak to the non-Muslims when a Muslim won't pay for this child, how do we answer and give the dawah to the non-Muslims? The Sheikh says it's important to know.
إذا كانت أم يلزمها الولد.
نعم.
قلت هذا؟
قل. نعم. The Sheikh asks me to reminds me, the mother must now take care of the child. نعم.
الأم مو بالأب.
نعم. Not the Sheikh says, he is not telling you not to spend on the child. He's saying you're not obliged. And this is something that's important to make this distinction. You may spend on the child if you have the ability. And this is something, inshallah, that may lead to future prospects of Muslims. But it is not something that you are obliged to do.
The next question to our Sheikh Abu Usama, is it permissible if one of our disbelieving relatives die to attend the funeral and not to participate in their kufr and their wailing and the way that they behave? إذا مات أحد من أقاربنا الكفار هل يجوز للمسلم أن يحضر جنازته ولا يشاركهم في تصرفاتهم الكفرية والسياحة أو النياحة وهذه الأمور، هل هذا يجوز؟
بالنسبة للمشرك إذا مات فيجوز للمسلم أن يكفنه، أن يغسله ويكفنه ويوريه التراب، لأن ذلك ثبت في حق أبي طالب عندما أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عليا أن يفعل ذلك، أن يفعل ذلك. ويحمل هذا على إن لم يكن لهذا المشرك أولياء كفار يقومون بذلك، وإن كان له أولياء فالأولى عدم ذلك، والله أعلم.
The Sheikh answers the question by saying, in regards to this question, it becomes, it is permissible for the Muslims to delegate a person to go and perform the ghusl and to perform the kafan for this person. But if the person has family lineage who will take up this responsibility in different ways, then it is not something that falls on the responsibility of the Muslims.
What would you tell a new Muslim in regards to making his prayer and the dhikr of Allah and things like this, being that he does not yet know how to properly do such forms of ibadah? No, because we're coming around. We have so much stuff. Okay, we have a question here concerning the issue of participating in the voting process. Is it permissible for the Muslims of the United States to choose a particular group of people to vote for? يسأل السائل يا شيخ أبو حاتم عن المشاركة في الانتخابات، هل يجوز للمسلم في أمريكا أن ينتخب أو يؤيد أحد الفريقين؟ نعم، هذا هو المشاركة في انتخاباتهم، هل هذا يجوز؟
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، أما بعد، هذه الأسئلة التي من هذا النوع لا بد من عرضها على كبار العلماء حتى يتكلموا فيها
بما يرونه من مصالح، والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم.
The Sheikh حفظه الله, he answers the question of this voting issue by saying such questions must be brought forth to a council of higher scholars who will then analyze the situation and give their fatwa accordingly. And Allah is the one who knows what is best.
Will Allah hold us responsible for what happens prior to al-Islam? هل يؤاخذنا الله تعالى بما فعلنا وقدمنا قبل إسلامنا؟
إن بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن ما فعلته قبل إسلامك فإنه ينقسم إلى قسمين, إما أعمال خير وإما أعمال شر. أما أعمال الخير إذا أسلمت فإنها تحتسب لك, لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما سئل عن أعمال بر كانت تعمل في الجاهلية كما في صحيح مسلم قال أسلمت على ما أسلفت من الخير, يعني لك أجر ما سبق من أمور الخير تؤجر عليها. وأما أعمال السوء أو المعاصي فهي تنقسم إلى قسمين, قسم يتعلق بحقوق العباد كأن سرقت مالا أو غصبته أو قتلت رجلا أو دما مسلما. فابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى قد ذكر في كتابه مدارج السالكين أن هذا يجب التحلل فيه من صاحب الحق وإرجاع المال إلى صاحبه, وأما سائر ذلك من الذنوب فإن الإسلام يجب ما قبله, وإثم تلك السرقة مغفور وإثم ذلك الغصب مغفور, لكن يجب عليك أن ترد المال المسروق أو المغصوب إلى صاحبه إن تمكنت منه, والله أعلم. وهو تقرير الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله.
The Sheikh answered this question about your actions that may have been committed before Islam. They are one of two things, either they are actions of righteousness or actions are evil. As for the actions of righteousness that you do before you are Muslim, it is counted for you and you shall be given the reward for it. And as for the actions of evil that you commit, they are of two types, that which you involved another human being with and that which you did not involve a human being with. These evil actions that you may have committed involving someone in the sin, you must return what you may have taken if you have stolen something or as such. Although Allah has forgiven your sin, you still must remove the oppression that you with your own hand have caused. The evil actions that a person commits are removed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while the good actions remain in place and will be counted by Allah.
Dear esteemed Sheikh, some of the ladies wear a long khimar that goes all the way to the waist. Is this sufficient or is it obligatory for them to wear the jilbab? تسأل السائل يا شيخ عن الخمار الذي يمتد من رأسها إلى إيش هذا الموضع؟ إلى وسطها وتحتها الذي يسترها كذلك من تحت, هل هذا كافي أو عليها أن تلبس الجلباب من رأسها إلى الأرض؟
أنتم أهل الجلباب والحجاب.
والله أعلم أن هذه المرأة إذا لبست لباسا يستر عموم بدنها يستره, ويكون هذا اللباس فضفاض لا يصف ولا يشف, فإنه حين وليس فيه زينة وليس فيه تشبه. انتبه, أربعة شروط: لا يصف ولا يشف, لا يصف بضيق ونحوه يكون ضيق, ولا يشف يكون شفاف يشف ما تحته, ولا يكون فيه زينة بلون أو بزي بتفصيل, يعني يكون لونه زينة أو تكون طريقة تفصيله فيها زينة, هذا الرابع. والخامس ألا يكون فيه تشبه بالرجال أو بالكفار, والتشبه معناه بالرجال أو بالكفار أن تلبس لباسا لا يلبسه إلا أهل الكفر. إذا رأيت قلت هذا لباس الكفار أو هذا لباس الرجال,
هذا هو التشبه بلباس الكفار ولباس الرجال. وقبل هذا كله طبعا أن يكون ساترا لعموم بدن المرأة إذ المرأة عورة. والله أعلم. ولباس الكبر والشهرة، وألا يكون لباس الشهرة. نعم حسنت.
In answering the question,
لو ذكرتها طيب.
أنا نسألك.
ما عندهم.
In
لا عندهم.
كله. In regards to answering this question, the Sheikh Hafidhahullah says he gives us the regulations that must be followed for the clothing to fulfill the requirements of hijab. First, the covering, the clothing must cover all the parts of the body that are not permitted to be seen by the strangers. Second, it must be opaque. You cannot see through it. You cannot tell the color of the skin or what is under the clothing. Third, it must not be, the clothing itself must not be beauty in itself. Meaning, either by design or color, it should not have beauty in it. Fourth, it should not give detail of the bodily features of the woman. Meaning, it should be vast and encompassing. You should not be able to tell the hips from the breasts or where the legs begin or end. Five, at-tashabbuh, whether it's the clothing of men or the clothing of the disbelievers, it should not be an exclusive clothing of men or the disbelieving women's dress. So if you see a Muslim woman, you would not say she is wearing the clothes that is exclusively known for a man or exclusively known for the women of the disbelievers. We added the clothing should not be perfumed or any perfume on the body of the woman.
أو شهرة.
And it should not be clothing that is going to call attention to oneself, whether because of its cost or its design or its material or things like this.
بما أنكم قلتم الشهرة وأنا ما أبغى أقولها، لكن الشهرة يجب ألا تكون هذه الشهرة مخالفة لنص الشريعة. فما يأتي رجل يقول الحجاب لبس شهرة، أن المرأة المحجبة تصير مشهورة في الناس. لا، الشهرة هي المقصود أن يكون أمرا، مو بأمر واجب عليها. واحد يلبس ثوب قصير يقول هذا شهرة، طول ثوبك عشان ما تصير مشتهر. لا، إذا أمر مأمور به ولو تفردت به يجب عليك أن تفعل.
The Sheikh explaining شهرة so none of us are confused into thinking, well, what if this clothing that the woman's wearing is making her distinct from everyone else? Therefore, this is شهرة. The laws of Allah must be upheld. So you would not say, well, I'm not going to let my wife dress in this clothing because it's going to be making her distinct and known to the people. This is something that is wrong and a misled understanding.
What is the age of a child that is acceptable as a mahram for a woman traveling? Is there any age or is it just puberty? Please explain. Yes, al-sa'il, ma huwa as-sin al-mu'tabar حتى يكون الطفل أو الصغير محرم للمرأة في سفرها. هذا هو السؤال. شيخ أبو حاتم.
الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده، أما بعد، يسأل السائل ما هو السن الذي يصلح الطفل فيه أن يكون محرما للمرأة؟ والجواب أن البلوغ لا يكفي، أن البلوغ لا يكفي، لأن المحرمية إنما تتوقف على حسن التصرف، وهذا لا يكون إلا بالرشد، فقبل الرشد لا تصرف لهذا الصبي في نفسه فضلا عن أن يتصرف في غيره. فالمعتبر هو الرشد، والرشد ليس له سن معينة يختلف الناس فيه. قال تعالى فإن آنستم منهم رشدا، وإن كان بعض البلاد فيه سن محددة في القانون للرشد فهذا يعني يعتبرونه على سبيل التغليب، وإلا فالرشد يختلف من إنسان إلى إنسان. فإذا شعر أن الصبي بلغ وبدأ يحسن التصرف ويعقل الأمور، وإذا تعرضت أمه وأخته لشيء يمكنه أن يتصرف، في هذه الحالة يصلح إن شاء الله أن يسافر معها محرما، والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم.
The Sheikh answers this question by saying the age of the mahram, the person who is accompanying a woman in travel or as such, the child must, it's not just that he has to be, not just that he has reached the age of puberty, but he also must be acting in a wise manner. Acting in a manner where he can handle the situations as they arise. And this is explained by the Sheikh using the word rushd, meaning maturity. It's a vague translation, but maturity, the Sheikh points out, in different countries they have different ages.
Understandable.
So, maturity. Now, this maturity, as the Sheikh points out, it's different in different places throughout the world. Maturity is not judged by age, it's judged by the actions of the person. So if the person is able to handle the situations as they arise, even if he is at a younger age than most other people, then it would be permitted for him to be as a mahram. And also, inversely, if a person who is old in age yet does not act in a mature manner and can deal with the situations, then he would not be a fit mahram.
If a Muslim oppresses another Muslim, like the man who has children from a woman who is divorced and he doesn't take care of his children, that's an example. If a Muslim oppresses another Muslim, like that example we just gave, and he prevents that Muslim from getting his rights, and the Muslim who is oppressed reports him and hands him over to the kuffar, is this wrong? لو ظلم مسلم مسلما يا شيخ ومنعه من حقوقه فدفع المظلوم هذا الظالم إلى المحكمة حتى تؤخذ منه حقوقه وهذا قصده الوحيد هل هذا فعل صحيح أو غلط يجوز أو لا يجوز
إذا ظلم مسلم أخاه المسلم ومنعه حقوقه فأول واجب على المظلوم أن يستنصر بإخوانه المسلمين فإن لم يستطيعه فإنه والله أعلم يجوز له أن يطلب حقه بواسطة هذه القوانين لأنه ليس مقصوده التحاكم إلى هذه القوانين وإنما مقصود الوصول إلى حقه والله أعلى وأعلم.
In regards to this situation, the Sheikh answers by saying the first duty of the person who is oppressed is to seek help from the Muslim community that is at large and around him. And if they are unable to protect him and to give him his rights and to return what may have been taken or whatever the situation may be, then it finds itself the only option to deem permissible to go into the law system and to get back the laws or the rights that a person has been oppressed with. And this is what the Shaykh has given, Wallahu A'lam, as he has concluded.
Please answer this question, Jazakallahu Khaira. Can a sister wear lipstick for her husband? Dawr Adeeb.
The way that Abu Osama has asked this question, it is as though that I am the husband. This is خبر مقدم مبتدأ مؤخر. I called a few months back. I called Sheikh Al-Ubaid Al-Jabiri in Medina, Habibullah, and asked him this question. And I also called Sheikh Ali Hassan, who's with us, within that same week, a few months ago. I asked both of them this question. And because the question that I had originally was, is wearing lipstick changing the creation of Allah? That was my original question. Is wearing lipstick changing the creation of Allah? And both of them answered, with a little bit of increase from one of them, that if the woman does this for the beautification of her husband, it's permissible. as long as she doesn't make that lipstick like a tattoo. Maybe some of you are not aware of this. Today, here in America and in other Western countries, women take the lipstick and make it a tattoo. They actually have the lipstick tattooed onto their lips, where they have this appearance all the time. This is going to be a haram, of course. We know, because the tattooing is haram. They also answered the question that it's not permissible for the non-married woman, Muslim woman, to wear it, because this is going to incite her to use it for another reason. As for the woman who's married, they said that as long as she's not excessive with it, she can do it for the pleasure and the beautification of her husband, and Allah knows best.
Can a woman who is on her menses, can she go to the masjid or to the musalla to seek knowledge? And there's a note, please explain or define the difference between the musalla and the masjid. Do all of the five prayers have to be prayed at the musalla? Yes, al-sa'il. هل يجوز للمرأة الحائض أن تحضر المسجد لتطلب العلم؟ وهل هناك فرق بين المصلى والمسجد؟ وهل تقام الصلوات الخمسة في المصلى كواجب؟
نعم، هذا لك يا شيخ.
تقول السائلة: هل يجوز للمرأة حال حيضها أن تذهب إلى المسجد لحضور حلقات العلم وسماع الدروس ونحو ذلك؟ وهذه أيضا مسألة الخلاف فيها قديم بين أهل العلم، والراجح في حدود علمي وبحسب فهمي أن هناك فرقا بين الدخول والمكث. فالمكث في المسجد للحائض والجنب محظور وممنوع، وأما الدخول فالدخول مأذون فيه، فالدخول مأذون فيه، أما الاستقرار والمكث فهذا ممنوع، وقد استدل العلماء بعمومات، ومن هذه العمومات أن طهر بيتي. فالشاهد أن هذا ما يترجح لي في هذه المسألة. وأما حضور الصلوات الخمسة على المرأة، هل هو لازم في المسجد؟ لا، ليس لازما، لا في المسجد ولا في المصلى، فإن هي فعلت فقد أجزأ إن شاء الله تعالى. وأما الأفضل فلا شك أن الأفضل للمرأة أنها تصلي في بيتها، والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم.
The Shaykh Hafizahullah answers this question by saying the difference of opinion amongst the scholars is vast and from a long period of time. As to his understanding, there are two different types of entrances into the masjid, or this issue of the masjid and the woman in her menstrual cycle. As for the first, it is entering the masjid and passing through it. And this, the Shaykh says, is permitted. But as for the second, which is dwelling and sitting inside the masjid when she's in her menstrual cycle, the Shaykh Hafidhahullah, and this is where the difference of opinion occurs, he says in his opinion this should not be upheld, it should be prohibited for her to stay inside the masjid for extended periods of time for dwelling in it. As for the statement or the question of the sister asking, compulsory for the person to pray the five daily prayers if they are a female in the mosque, the Shaykh says it is not compulsory, but if she does so, there is no problem with it. But it must be known that praying at the home for the Muslim woman is what is best for her. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam.
The next question came up no less than 8 times, and I had to keep putting it on the side because I'm being put in a position that's not comfortable. I have on one end the people who are writing the questions, they're going to come to me and say, why didn't you write that question or ask that question? You know it's something we're dealing with. And then in asking the question, the Shaykh is going to say to me, how can you put me in this ihraj? So I wanted to ubari udhimmati with this muqaddama here. I'm going to ask the question, and wallahi my niyyah is not to make any ihraj, so that the Shaykh won't be looking at me like I'm crazy. And on the other hand, I'm going to ask a question of something that we're dealing with. And that is, what is the ruling of oral sex? What is the ruling of oral sex? And we held this question in the system so that it can come to Abu Abdurrahman.
I get used to this kind of questions.
How can I say it in Arabic?
يعني هل المرأة يجوز لها أن تمص ذكر زوجها؟ عند فقهاء الحنفية
شيخ أبو حازم كان مصوب ومربي الآن أنا متحدث
لا إن شاء الله
رفع هذا السؤال في هذا المقام
جاز الشيخ صح نعم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله سئل سماحة الوالد العلامة الشيخ عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز هذا السؤال بعينه فقال سماحة الشيخ أنه يكرهه وأنه مكروه قال أنه مكروه وأما العكس ولا أداة للمرأة سأحرجك بالترجمة كما أحرجتموني وأما العكس والمرأة لا أداة لها فإن بعض فقهاء المالكية قد أجازه نعم
الله أكبر
وهذا ذكره القرطبي
اجتهاد
بالنسبة لهذه المسألة فقد سئل شيخنا الشيخ الألباني حفظه الله فقال هذا لا يجوز لأن هذا فيه تشبه بالكفار تشبه بالحيوانات فلا يجوز والله أعلم
In regards to the answer of this question Sheikh Waleed al-Basyuni narrates to us from Sheikh Ibn Baz who was directly asked this question as you have asked today many times Sheikh Ibn Baz when he was asked this question he said it is something that is hated for the man to have performed on him. This is something that is hated and should not be done, for it is an evil act.
أما المرأة قل أما المرأة ولا أداة لها ولكنه ذكر بعض فقهاء المالكية جواز ذلك من الرجل أن يلعق
The Sheikh mentions as is found in the Maliki Madhab as is found in the book of Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi I remember he was mentioning that as for the man performing on his wife then this is something that they have permitted Sheikh Al-Albani, as Sheikh Salim Al-Hilali narrated to us when he was asked this question, he said, it is something that is prohibited, for it is something that only the animals would think of doing or would perform.
Women are not supposed to wear clothes like kuffar. Is it also the same for men that they shouldn't dress like kuffar? For an example, tucking the shirt inside of the pants. لَقَدْ حَرَّمَ الدِّينَ على المرأة أن تشبه بالكافرات ألا يكون هذا الحكم منطبق على الرجال كذلك الرجال من المسلمين ألا يتشبهون بالكفار كذلك مثل أن يجعل الرجل قميصه مثل هذا قميص داخل بنطلونه هل هذا من التشبه بالكفار
Brother Muhammad be careful he said like this قميص
يعني حتى لا يظن الثوب القميص القميص القصير
بالنسبة للتشبه بالكفار فإنه لا يجوز من الرجال ومن النساء لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تشبه بقوم فهو منهم وعن الحقيقة أن لبس البنطال أيضا هو يعني يكره للمسلم، وكراهة يعني تصل إلى حد التحريم أحيانا، لأنه فيه عدة مفاسد. مفاسد الأول أنه فيه تشبه، وفيه أيضا تجسيم للعورة، ويتأكد هذا الكراهة تتأكد هذه الكراهة خاصة في أداء الصلوات في البنطال، وخاصة إذا كان ضيقا مثل الجنز وغيره. فكثير بعض العلماء يعني حرم الصلاة في الملابس الحازقة الضاغطة التي تصف العورة وتجسمها.
The Sheikh answers this question by saying, as for tashabbuh, following the examples or looking and appearing like other people, it is not permitted in any shape, way, or form for both men and women, for this is something that the Prophet ﷺ has prohibited. But as for the question of men wearing pants, it is something that the ulama have said is something that is hated. And at certain levels, it may reach to the point where it becomes haram when the person is in the state of wearing pants that are exposing or extenuating or portraying his awra, or his that are tight jeans or tight pants, especially at the time of salah, when a person is going down in prostration and things like this. In these situations, a person must be careful. Some of the scholars have therefore prohibited the salah to be performed in tight pants in such situations. Wallahu alam.
There are some imams who are of the opinion if a man divorces his wife, that he can continue to have sexual relationships with her during the iddah, and his niyyah is not to take her back but just to enjoy her. And he claims that this is from the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Is this true or not true? هذا السؤال إلى شيخ أبي عبد الرحمن يفتي.
I think that the person is making a mistake. We should be, I mean, just to the question. I mean, the person was asking the question. The person, the people who have that opinion, who've been saying that in this country, they're saying that it's not from Ibn Taymiyyah. They're saying it's from Imam Shafi'i and Layth and Ibn Hazm, not Ibn Taymiyyah.
المهم السؤال هو يفتي بعض الأئمة بأن الرجل إن طلق زوجته فيجوز له أن يستمتع بها خلال عدتها، ولا يقصد بهذا الاستمتاع مراجعتها، ما يريد أن يراجعها، فيستمتع بها خلال عدتها، فإذا قضت عدتها فهي مطلقة لها أن تمشي وتنصرف.
ويقصد الأئمة أئمة الأمريكيين.
هل هذا يجوز ولا يجوز؟ وهل هذا القول منصوب إلى إمام معروف من أئمة الإسلام؟
رجال من عندك.
نعم هذا من
عندك. التفصيلات إن شاء الله.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد، فإن الرجل إذا طلق امرأته تطليقتها الأولى أو الثانية وما زالت المرأة في عدتها، فإنه يراجعها بأحد طريقين. الطريق الأول أن يراجعها بأي لفظ أو فعل يدل على المراجعة، كقول ابن عباس إذا قبلها أو حضنها فذلك فإنه قد راجعها. ولذلك ذكر الفقهاء أن أمثلة كثيرة على الإرجاع بمجرد حركات غالبها يعني يصب في النهاية إلى أشياء تؤدي إلى الموافقة على أن يرجعوا كزوجين. والأمر الثاني بالجماع، فبمجرد أن يجامعها تصبح زوجته مرة أخرى، تصبح زوجته مرة أخرى. فإذا أراد أن يطلقها يجب عليه أن ينتظر حتى تحيض ثم تطهر، فإذا طهرت ما يقربها، وإنما يوقع الطلاق حينئذ. أما أن يوقع الطلاق في حيض قد جمعها فيه أو في حيضها فهو طلاق بدعي محرم، والخلاف على وقوعه أو عدم وقوعه مشهور، والذي تميل إليه النفس عدم وقوعه، وليس هذا المقصود. لكنني أتعجب
من هذا السؤال الذي قد سئلته قبل ذلك. كيف الرجل يقول أنه, أنه يأتي للمرأة ويفي عدته يجامعها ثم لا تطلق فقط ليقضي شهوته منها؟ إن الشريعة ما جعلت المرأة تسكن مع الرجل في بيته في وقت عدتها إلا لهذا المقصد, أن يأتي أن ترجع نفسه تشتغله فيأتي إليها فترجع الحياة الزوجية مثل ما كانت. هذا أول شيء. والعدة من أحكامها التي شرعها الله من أجلها استبراء الرحم لعله يستبرئ رحمها, وإلا لماذا لا يطلقها في حيض قد جمعها فيه؟ فهذا قول أنا لا أعرف نسبته إلى قول إمام من أئمة أهل العلم, لكنني أنا متأكد أن كثير ممن يقولون هذا القول لا يتبعون فيه إماما وإنما يتبعون فيه شهوتهم, والله أعلم.
أحسنت يا شيخ أبو عبد الرحمن.
The sheikh answers this question about talaq and raj'a and bringing back the wife by saying the man who divorces his wife, he can only, and she is in her state of idda, meaning period where she must stay in the house with him before she is fully divorced, this transition period between marriage and divorce, if it is not the third divorce that he declares on her, there are two things that if he does, she becomes back to him as his wife. The first, if he says a word or does an action that brings her back or shows her that he wants her back as his wife. As Abdullah ibn, Abbas showed, if he kisses her or hugs her or says to her, you are now back with me. The second thing is if he has sexual relations with her. Any one of these two things, she becomes automatically back to him as his wife. And this is why, and if he wants to divorce her fully, after he has had sexual relations with her, he must wait for the full month until she has her period, then he must wait, or else if he divorces her in this time period, before she has her menstrual cycle, it is called bid'ah type of divorce. But we will not get into the specifics as the Sheikh has pointed out. The Sheikh said there are two things that we must understand, which is the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deemed in the Sharia that the woman is to stay in the house with the husband and not to be expelled from it, is so that he may be enticed by her to return her back into regular life with him, so that she will not be divorced. This is the reason that she is to remain. The second is to be sure that there is nothing inside her rahim, in her womb, no baby has been conceived and as such. Therefore the Shaykh comes to the conclusion that those who state that a scholar has said that a person may enjoy his wife with the intention of divorcing her after he has said talaq in this period of iddah.
It's not intention.
No.
Divorcing, لا, هو مش عنده نية طلاق, هو
أصلاً مطلقة. نعم, نعم, نعم. Who has said the word talaq but intends to divorce her, also not keep her, not return her, and enjoys her company? This is a person who is not following any of the statements of the scholars, for the shuyukh here say they have not read or heard of something such as this, and they are most likely following their own lusts and desires and their shahawat, wallahu ta'ala a'lam.
We have so many questions here, brothers and sisters. After reading them, they are extremely beneficial. Islamic music, is it halal? And what do we do with our records and our tapes prior to Islam? When working with the kuffar and they give us extra pay around these holiday times, is it permissible? The sister said that, what do you do about debts that you acquire prior to al-Islam? She has another sister who's married to a brother who has kids by another woman. What's her responsibility and the priorities? Does the husband's priorities begin with her first or the children? There are so many very important issues that are affecting our lives that I see what we should do is tomorrow earlier, doing one of the slots of a class or a lecture, we get any of the shuyukh who are available and we replace that lesson or lecture with these questions right here, inshallah. Because it's too late now and it's 11 o'clock and we want to stay within the framework of what we're trying to do. Lastly, we want to give thanks and recognize what the brother Yahya is doing, because out of everyone who's participating, the most difficult job right here, right now, is the translation. Because he has to write down, memorize, concentrate, and then speak and try to keep you involved. Whereas the Sheikh rests until the ball comes back.